it's an enormous pleasure for me to be part of this amazing event that Advancing Green Chemistry has developed. If you know me, I've been watching endocrine disruption in particular and worrying about it for many, many years. And the people in this room really, truly inspire me, both the green chemist and the environmental health scientist. And it's been one of the great privileges of my career to get to know these people, their work, and to get to call them friends. Okay, our first speaker is one of our wonderful leaders from the National Institutes of Environmental Health Sciences, Dr. Jerry Heindel. He's a scientific program administrator at NIEHS in the Division of Extramural Research and Training, Cellular Organ and Systems Pathology Branch. Dr. Heindel is responsible for developing a portfolio of grants in the area of endocrine toxicology. He's enormously supportive of this area, including endocrine disruptors, reproductive and developmental toxicology, including the developmental basis of disease. And he also manages the small business, the SBIR and SDTR programs, with the goal of developing the data that will protect the American people from exposures to environmental chemicals. Dr. Heindel came to NIEHS to serve as leader of reproductive and developmental toxicology group. Prior to being at NIEHS, Dr. Heindel was an academic in several distinguished positions. Dr. Heindel, as I've come to know him, is a true gentleman public servant, a hero for our times, a man who works for his country and for mankind to do the right thing, come what may. He received his PhD in biochemistry from the University of Michigan and did his postdoctoral work at the University of Geneva, at the University of Houston, and at the University of Houston Medical Center. It's my great privilege to introduce you to Dr. Jerry Heindel.
Thank you very much for that nice introduction. It's great to be here, and it's really terrific to see such great interest in this topic. So as you just heard, I'm from the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. We're part of NIH, and we're the one part out of all 27 institutes and centers that focuses on the role of environment in causing disease and dysfunction. And so because of that, we're the one institute that really funds the majority of research in this particular area. So I'm going to quickly remind you that there are a lot of endocrine disruptors and that they're everywhere, and then focus my attention on the fact that they cause disease and that the most sensitive time for these endocrine disrupting chemicals to cause disease is during development. So this is just to give you an idea that when we're talking about endocrine disrupting chemicals, we're not just talking 2 or 5 or 10. And this is a very small example. There are literally hundreds of chemicals out there made for some specific purpose, but that have a side effect of disrupting the endocrine system. So all of these chemicals are designed as herbicides, but they're also endocrine-disrupting chemicals. Similarly, all these are fungicides. These are insecticides and a lot of industrial chemicals, but they all have one side effect, that they disrupt the endocrine system. So we're talking about a huge number of chemicals here that interact in a variety of mechanisms to affect the system. And in addition, they're everywhere. We initially saw they were in plastics, and that, as I showed you, pesticides and fungicides and herbicides. But now we know they're in disinfectant soaps. They're in water disinfection byproducts. They're in cosmetics and suntan lotions. They're everywhere we're looking. In fact, we don't even know where to all look, because in many cases, we don't know what's in a lot of chemicals. It's only recently we found out that many endocrine-disrupting chemicals are in cosmetics because they're not listed on the label. So that's the first two important points. There are a lot of them, and they're everywhere. And it turns out that these chemicals can be toxic at any time during life. And if you give these chemicals during adulthood, that can cause toxicity. But really, the most sensitive time is during development. And that's the time when the tissues are forming, there's no DNA repair system, there's no immune system, there's no blood-brain barrier, so chemicals can get into places they normally wouldn't get in as adults. And there's very immature detoxification systems and liver metabolism, so toxicants last a lot longer. And for all of these reasons, the system is much more sensitive. This is the time when all these tissues are forming and a lot of differentiation is going on. It's a very highly orchestrated system. And what's really important then is this is the time then when this genetic and epigenetic programming is occurring, that these epigenetic marks are being laid down so that if you have chemicals there, they can interfere with the setting of these marks and then lead to disease later in life. So you can have an environmental chemical that can cause immediate toxic effects and be there as long as the chemical persists. You take the chemical away, the effect goes away. And that seems to be what happens quite a bit in the adult situation. But if the exposure is during development, when these epigenetic marks are being set, then the effects of that exposure can persist throughout life and eventually lead to disease and dysfunction. So there's a whole new field has been developed in the last about 10 years called the developmental basis of disease. And in animal models, all of these diseases have been shown to fit that paradigm. That is to say, you can give an environmental chemical during development, and development for purposes here is not just in utero, it can also be neonatally. Development means developmental time period for that particular organ or tissue. And so some tissues are still developing in the first few years of life, as you're aware. So look at all these major human diseases that we can show in an animal model can be exacerbated due to an environmental chemical exposure just during development, including cardiovascular diseases, heart diseases, immune, autoimmune, attention deficit disorders, Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, fertility, and breast and prostate cancer. Now at NIEHS, we've been trying to find a role for environment in breast cancer for 20 years. But for a long time, we now realize we were doing it wrong, and that's why we never found anything. We were looking at age 40 years old in women, measuring what chemicals were in them, and then trying to relate that to breast cancer a few years later. And now we see that that paradigm doesn't work. What we need to do is to be looking during development at what exposures were there, and then try to relate that to the disease later in life. So the chemical is there only for that short time, and then it looks like nothing is happening, but 10, 20, 40 years later, the disease shows up. And these are some of the chemicals that were found to be important in this. Some of these environmental estrogens, you heard about the diethylstilbestrol and bisphenol A, methoxychlor as an insecticide, phthalates that's in polyvinyl carbonate, vinclozolin, smoking, atrazine as a herbicide, flame retardants, the chemicals in Teflon and Scotchgard. So they're all over the board, different kinds of chemicals that act through different mechanisms. I'll give one quick example of the bisphenol A, which is in the polycarbonate bottles. And we just want to look at the left-hand side. If you give developmental exposure to very low levels of bisphenol A, the same kind of levels that you would find in humans, but do it in mice and rats, and let these animals grow up, later you can get breast cancer, prostate cancer, sperm count decreases, early puberty, impaired learning and hyperactivity, all that relates to major health trends that we're seeing in the population today. That doesn't mean, of course, bisphenol A is responsible for all these health trends, but now we see in the animal models that you get this increased disease, and it tells us now perhaps we need to be looking more carefully in the humans for those same endpoints. Now I want to give one more example, and this is an example using vinclozolin, which is a fungicide, and methoxychlor, a herbicide. And it was given to pregnant mother rats just a very short time, for a few days during that pregnancy. And then you look at the pups, and then you take the males that came here, and you remate them with normal females and get a second generation, and then you take those males and you mate them for four generations. Only this mother was exposed, and thereby her pups. And you ask, what happens? So this is in the third generation, just looking in the testis. And that's all you have to notice is that these are the vinclozolin ones, and that this looks different from that. And what that says is that our complete infertility in 10% of these animals, but 90% of them have reduced sperm counts, and that lasts for four generations. And it's not decreasing with each generation, it stays that same. 10% complete infertility, 90% reduced sperm counts. And not only that, but you can look in other tissues, and you can see over four generations here, this increase in immune problems, kidney problems, prostate, and different kinds of tumors. So these animals really get messed up only from exposure at a very specific time during pregnancy, and that this effect lasts all those generations. So this is it's a couple years old now, but it's still preliminary type data. We need a lot more people to replicate it. But if it's true, just imagine the implications. So that says what your great-grandmother and grandmother were exposed to during pregnancy is affecting your health today. And what you're exposed to when you're pregnant will be affecting your children and their children and their children down the line. So this is really huge. These are environmental chemicals disrupting the endocrine system during development and causing these effects that we have to remove from the environment. So how does this actually work? I mentioned this works through epigenetics, and it's exactly the way Dr. Goldman explained. The gene is normal. There's no mutation in the gene, and then you have an environmental exposure, and you get abnormal expression. The gene is expressed when it shouldn't be expressed. So at birth, you look at these animals and they look completely normal. There's no birth defects, the weight is normal, but inside the tissues there's functional changes. Some genes are turned on and off that shouldn't be turned on and off. And eventually over the lifetime, those tissues then being abnormal at the biochemical level developed disease states. So the environmental exposures can acutely and directly cause altered gene expression via signal transduction pathways, and they can alter long-term timing of gene expression via this epigenetic pathway. And you already heard about the epigenetic pathway, the methylation of cytosines on the DNA, and the modification of the histone proteins, and how those marks then determine the accessibility of the transcription machinery, which transcribes the DNA into RNA and then to proteins. So these epigenetic marks then control gene expression, turning genes on and off. And while the epigenetic machinery is partly pliable throughout life, the most sensitive time when these marks are set and then become quite stable throughout life is during this developmental time period. And that's why it's the most sensitive period. So what we're having then is during development, you can have environmental toxicants, you can have drugs like DES, even maternal care and diet. They alter the epigenetic machinery, alter gene expression programming, give you individual phenotype differences that then alter your susceptibility to disease and your sensitivity to drugs and things like that that we all know about. So epigenetics then is at the core here, and it's really huge, burgeoning area. And across the NIH, there's over 700 individual grants working at some mechanism of epigenetics. But because it's so important, the NIH has put extra money into it, looking at epigenetics and human disease, and that's $8 million this year, and that money will increase each year over the next 5 years. Through what's called the RM here, meaning Roadmap Initiative. These are trans-institute initiatives, where all the institutes get together and work to move this field. And you can see the kinds of money over the next 5 years that's being put in to understand this epigenetics. So the developmental basis of disease really changes everything. It says that developmental nutrition and environmental chemical exposures alters gene expression via epigenetics, leading to functional changes in tissues that leads to increased susceptibility to disease. And what that implies then is that the health outcomes can be determined by environmental exposures that occurred early in life, possibly decades before the disease becomes apparent. And there are numerous examples now in the animal literature. This field is still new, and we're still just getting started in the epigenetics and endocrine disruptors and fetal basis paradigm in humans, because you can imagine how complex this is to do in humans, where you have to have exposure data during development and then alter gene expression to show that some functional change occurred, and then wait 20, 30, 40 years and see if you get increased disease that relates to that. So that's a problem that we have to work our way through, and we're doing that by finding disease where people have frozen serum that's 20, 30, 40 years old, and then now can look at the exposure in that serum and relate that to disease. So we're trying to move this field along that way. So this paradigm then really changes the focus from trying to cure a disease to trying to prevent the disease by preventing exposures. And also then, if you know you've been exposed, maybe you can develop intervention strategies. We can't any longer wait till people get disease, go to the doctor and try to be cured. The goal here is to try to figure out that who's susceptible and to prevent that disease. And of course, it's both genetics and environment. We're never going to understand a disease completely by looking just at genetics. It's going to always be gene-environment interaction, because for every complex disease, there's a role for the environment. Sometimes it might be only 2 or 5%. Sometimes it'll be 40 to 60%, depending upon the disease. This paradigm then changes the focus also from adults to development is the cause of the disease. And it focuses on epigenetics as the mechanism. And we know that you can measure these epigenetic marks, and we can use these epigenetic marks then as biomarkers to indicate that you've been exposed, and then to try to develop intervention strategies. Since we know the epigenetic marks are basically stable, but yet they are modifiable, we should be able to then eventually develop procedures to modify these epigenetic marks and bring those tissues back into normal situation. So that's what I wanted to tell you, to remind you how perverse these endocrine disrupting chemicals are and how important they are during development. Thank you very much.